If you're watching this video, chances are you are not as fast at solving SAT math problems as you would like to be. Now, there are probably a bunch of reasons for this, but one of the most important and one that almost nobody talks about is mental arithmetic. Because the truth is that you just won't raise your score from a 700 to an 800 unless you become blazingly fast at mental arithmetic. But before we jump into that, here's an SAT problem. It's one of the hardest questions you'll find on any given test, but with solid mental math abilities, it's solvable without Desmos in about 10 seconds. So rewind, pause the video, and give it a go. And later on, I'll explain exactly how it's done. Now, just to be clear, I've got nothing against Desmos. It's absolutely the fastest and most reliable way to boost your SAT math score. So yes, Desmos is necessary, but it is not sufficient. Not if you're shooting for a top score. Are crazy regressions helpful? Absolutely. But if you really want to break ahead of the pack, you will need to sharpen your mental arithmetic and number sense. So how do you know if you're quick enough? Here's a quick fire quiz. Ready? 7 times 8, 90 minus 65, 1 minus 0.84, 12 times 12, square root of 169, 2025 minus 1987, 2 to the power of 5, 1 half plus 1 third. Now, if you didn't immediately know the answer to every one of these, the honest truth is that you're missing out on real opportunities. And you're probably leaking a substantial amount of time and points as well, not only in the SAT, but in your high school math tests too. Because I assure you that every student who scores a 790 or 800 in the math doesn't need to reach for a calculator to subtract 65 from 90. So if you're stuck around a 700 and you've already got Desmos on lock, one of the best things you can do to practice is forbid yourself from using technology. Not forever, and definitely not during the real test. But by setting yourself a constraint, you will be forced to reason in totally new ways, ways the top scorers often do pretty naturally. In this video, I want to discuss 3 specific benefits of blazingly fast mental math. Number 1, faster calculations. Number 2, greater accuracy. And number 3, improved pattern recognition. So let's begin with the first point, speed. If you've got your multiplication tables absolutely burnt into your nervous system, many SAT questions can, and really should, be solved in your head. Like this one, where 88 over 8 is just 11, or in this one, where 28 over 7 is 4, and 8 times 4 is 32, or finally in this one, where if you know your quadratic formula well, you'll recognize that the answer choices are all in the form minus b plus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, all over 2a. So we can just calculate those components one at a time, eliminating answer choices as we go. Minus b is minus minus 3, which is 3, so we can eliminate answers c and d within 5 seconds, and we're down to 2 answer choices already. Now we just need to calculate 3 squared minus 4 times 1 times 1, which is 9 minus 4, which gives 5. So the answer is just A. Yes, you can solve this question with Desmos too, but it's pretty awkward because the answer choices aren't regular numbers, they're surds. So to see which option matches your Desmos solution, you're going to have to type the answer choices into your calculator until you find one that matches. And all that could easily take you over a minute, which is way longer than the mental calculations we performed earlier, which took about 20 seconds. Now, I want to make this next point absolutely clear. In the real SAT, when every point is critical, if these calculations aren't automatic, you should just use Desmos, because the aim of improving your mental math isn't to prove a point or show off. It's to both go faster and make fewer mistakes. So if it's slowing you down or you're screwing up your calculations, that means you need more practice and you are not ready to apply these ideas in the real test. Okay, with that out of the way, let's move on to the next point, accuracy. When your mental arithmetic is really solid, dumb mistakes become really easy to notice and fix up, usually within a few seconds after the mistake occurs. You don't even have to consciously do anything, it just kind of happens, automatically. Now, if you're a bit skeptical of what I'm saying, just think about this sentence, "Me likes toast." Is that a well-formed sentence? Obviously not. And did you have to think about it? Did you consciously analyze the sentence, observing that me is in the object form when it should be in the subject form, I or that like should be conjugated in the first person singular? Of course not. You could just tell that me likes toast is wrong. Well, have I got news for you. The kids who get an 800 without breaking a sweat can just hear that 7 times 6 isn't 49. So if you can't hear it, you are at a massive disadvantage. Let's look at another example. This one's a bit harder conceptually, but basically if you can spot that the two equations must have the same coefficient to produce an equation with no solution, you can simply divide 48 over 17 by 3. That may look like it's impossible to do in your head, but if you know your fractions and your multiplication tables, you'll know that we can rearrange this fraction like so, swapping the 3 and the 17, so it's really just 48 over 3 divided by 17, which is just 16 over 17. And the fraction form is perfectly acceptable on the SAT, so you're done. Now, let's say you choose not to take the risk. You punch 48 divided by 17 over 3 into Desmos, which results in 144 over 17. But that's not what we got before, which is not good. Not good. Now, if you know how numbers work, deep in your bones, you will have noticed that the fractions are incorrectly constructed in Desmos. This is a super common error because it feels completely natural to type 48/17/3 in one go. And sadly, most of you will just never notice it because most of you haven't taken the time to learn your fractions properly. So when you make that mistake, you haven't got a clue. So what's the best approach? Is it with Desmos or should you do this one in your head? Well, both. Basically, especially for top scores. First, calculate it in your head, just as we did before, which for anyone scoring above a 720 should be doable within a few seconds. And then, verify your result with Desmos like so. All you need to do is split the equation into two linear functions. Now we solve for m with a regression by typing out 2k squiggle 48 over 17, which automatically defines n and produces parallel lines, i.e. a system with no solution. If you've screwed up one or the other method, your two answers will diverge. But if they agree, you're pretty close to 100% sure you got it right. And this level of certainty is critical when you're aiming for a perfect score, because remember, a single mistake can cost you upwards of 30 points on the nastiest curves, which is one of the reasons, incidentally, that it's so hard to get an 800 in the SAT math section. But I digress. So let's get back on track and move on to the last point, improved pattern recognition. This is probably the most important and least discussed of the three. When you've truly mastered mental arithmetic, you'll start to notice shortcuts within questions and patterns between questions almost instantaneously. Let's jump into an example and I'll show you what I mean. Triangle ABC is similar to triangle DEF, where angle A corresponds to angle D and angles C and F are right angles. The length of AC is 11 and the length of AB is 2.9 times the length of DE. If cosine of A equals 21 over 35, what is the value of cosine of E? In this question here, many students will notice that they can use SOHCAHTOA and the Pythagorean theorem to find the lengths of the missing sides. They'll then use the properties of similar triangles to calculate the lengths of the smaller triangle, dividing each side by 2.9 to get this. And now that they've solved for just about everything they could possibly solve for, it's simple enough to see that cosine of E is just adjacent over hypotenuse, which thankfully simplifies nicely and our answer is 4 over 5. Even with a calculator, this method is slow and really easy to screw up. More importantly, it completely misses the point of the question, because this question, surprise, surprise, is doable in your head. The key is to spot that this question is all about divisibility and the 3-4-5 triangle. Can you tell that 35 and 21 share a common factor? You guessed it, they're both divisible by 7. And since similar triangles all share the same proportions, we can vastly simplify our task by reducing our Pythagorean theorem to 3 squared plus x squared equals 5 squared, which you may recognize, in fact, which you should recognize as the Pythagorean triple 3-4-5. So our missing side length is 4. Now, do we have to figure out the lengths of all the sides in triangles ABC and DEF? Not if you understand how ratios work. When we multiply our triangle's side lengths by any given scale factor, the resulting triangle's side lengths will always maintain the same proportions. So cosine of A will always equal cosine of D, cosine of B will always equal cosine of E, and so on and so forth, for whatever trig ratio you choose. In other words, we can just use our 3-4-5 triangle to determine the value of cosine of E. We just label our 3-4-5 triangle's angles as DEF, and cosine of E is then just equal to the adjacent side, which is 4, over the hypotenuse, which is 5. So 4 over 5. And we're done. Notice that 90% of the given information is just there to distract you. You might think that's unfair, but the truth is that SAT questions, like any question on any meaningful test, is designed to separate those who know a thing from those who do not know that thing. And this particular question is very well designed, because if you don't know your fundamentals really well, even if you get it right, it'll take you anywhere from 3 to 5 minutes to solve, while the top 1% of test takers will take closer to 30 seconds. So, always keep an eye out for easy opportunities to simplify, because this type of simplification pops up all the time on the SAT. So if you can learn to spot a common pattern or repeating unit, the College Board usually rewards you for it. Here we divide by 3 to solve directly for x squared minus 6x. Here we divide by 6 to solve directly for x plus 6. And here we can vastly simplify our problem by dividing every term by 20 to get 1 over p equals 1 over q minus 1 over r minus 1 over s. In fact, this last question, which is the teaser from the start of the video, if you'll recall, is surprisingly easy to do in your head. It's come up before in the real SAT, and for some reason, even high-scoring students get tripped up by it all the time. So, it's legitimately hard, and yet, once you've slashed the 20s and isolated 1 over q, the answer is kind of obvious if you know a thing or two about adding fractions. To demonstrate the idea, let's look at a toy version of our problem. To add our fractions, we need a common denominator, which we can easily find by multiplying 5 by 6, which is 30. So option C is the only answer that makes any sense. And we're done. Let's look at a marginally more complex example. The first part of our problem is the same. To add up these fractions, they'll need a common denominator of 8 times 7, so 56. But this time, whatever we get in the denominator here will eventually wind up as the numerator here, because dividing anything by a fraction is the same as multiplying that thing by the fraction's reciprocal. So our final numerator is 56, which is answer D. Okay, back to our problem. So pause the video and take a minute to see if you can use what we just discussed to solve this problem without setting pen to paper. The pattern is the same as in the last two examples, except with a few more letters. So really, rewind the video if you need to and give it a proper go before watching my explanation. Okay? All right. Here is how it is done. We're clearly going to need a common denominator here to combine these fractions, which, just as before, will be p times r times s. And once that's done, what we'll get will be something over prs equals 1 over q. Now we just flip the fractions to get prs over that thing. And that's answer C. Far-fetched? I guarantee you the top 1% of test takers see it. They see it because they had good teachers, or helpful parents, or private tutors who drilled it into them from a young enough age that these sorts of algebraic manipulations just make sense. So, hopefully by now, I've sold you on this point, which raises the question, what should you actually do to improve? First is that you must memorize your multiplication tables up to 12 times 12. If you know more, great. Personally, I haven't bothered memorizing 14 times 17 or 12 times 19, but you definitely want to know your perfect squares up to 20 squared. I also recommend that you are able to add and subtract numbers up to 100 almost instantaneously, that you're able to add and subtract fractions with uncommon denominators up to 12, that you can convert basic fractions to decimals and vice versa, and that you can recognize pairs of numbers that add up to 90 and 180 for geometry and trigonometry problems. Honestly, 10 minutes per day, and within a few months, you'll be ripping through questions faster than 99% of the population. But to get there, you will have to go back to basics. And that is hard. It's hard because you will always find excuses to not go back to basics. You don't have time. You'd rather focus on the hardest SAT questions. You don't think it'll make a big difference. But unless everything you saw in this video was painfully obvious, you are just wrong. And the honest truth is that to speed up, you really will need to go way back and get disgustingly fast at what you learned, or rather didn't learn, in primary and middle school. Because if you think you're going to get significantly faster by just answering hundreds and hundreds of SAT questions without fundamentally changing your approach, you are delusional. And this is going to be true no matter what topic or field of study you are attempting to master. You can swing a golf ball 100,000 times if you aren't consciously and intentionally focusing on what's screwing up your drive, you will not improve. Not significantly. All you will be doing is automating your mistakes, and you will keep getting faster and more efficient at your very slow and very inefficient approach. Simply put, if you want to see progress, you must, you absolutely must step out of your comfort zone. Because if your prep always feels warm and soft and comfortable, that means you are not learning. You are not expanding your skills or your resilience. And when test day comes along, you will not improve either. Your scores will plateau and you will feel depressed. But if instead you exercise just a little self-discipline, you return to fundamentals and you treat every question with care, you will steadily expand your limits and find yourself calm under pressure when it actually matters.